Who doesn't know it? The most famous recording studio in the world, Abbey Road. I'm Oliver from Spitfire Audio, and I'm extremely honored to present to you Abbey Road One Orchestral Foundations, the first in a series of film scoring selections recorded at Abbey Road Studios. This library is a standalone library organized in ensemble, which means that the orchestra or sections of the orchestra are laid out on your keyboard and you can play them either with both hands or one hand on the controller here. It just jumps out of the box, mixed and orchestrated for you. The library is incredibly expressive. It features 69 articulations and up to 5 dynamic layers. And of course, we haven't forgotten about the famous microphone cupboard at Abbey Road. We've included 10 individual signals as well as 2 mix signals. So let me just give you a quick play how this sounds and how this looks. So here we have the whole orchestra. So the whole orchestra, including strings, woods and brass, are laid out on the keyboard. And then we have the individual sections here, strings, low and highs, trumpets, horns, low brass, high woods, low woods, and then the different percussive elements. I just want to show you, give you a little flavor of the sounds quickly here. So I'm playing the whole orchestra longs. Some shorts. Really cool. And then we've included some useful swells here. What a fantastic sound and a really, really lovely reverb tail right there, which you can also control, by the way, as with our usual libraries. So, as the title says, Orchestral Foundations, this is a very good foundation in your toolbox. We'll be releasing more libraries that will go really well with Abbey Road One, focused on certain goals and elements, such as legato or epic brass. And these libraries, you'll be able to purchase separately. You can use them separately, or of course in combination with Abbey Road or even other libraries. And that's not to say that this library, you can't combine it with other libraries. You can combine it with our solo strings, with LCO. You can even combine it with live elements, how I've done here in my piece. So I want to take you down the nostalgic route. So I've put together a selection of film scores recorded at Abbey Road. We'll listen to them, we'll look at the film poster, etc. And then you can see how I drew inspiration from these scores to write my own piece. Towards the end, we'll be looking at my piece to a short analysis as well. And if you wish to have an in-depth look what's in the library, please check out Paul's walkthrough. Right, enough talking for the moment. Let me play you the piece. Thank you. As said, we'll look at a few scores now, look a little bit at history. If you want to jump straight to the tutorial, please skip ahead. So, why is Abbey Road so famous? You've guessed it. Abbey Road is best known for being the creative home of the Beatles. And this is probably one of the most famous album covers of all time, the 1969 album with the simple name Abbey Road. The Beatles recorded most of their music at Abbey Road between 1962 and 1970. It became the mecca for British pop and rock music during the 60s and would host artists such as Cliff Richard and the Shadows, The Hollies, The Zombies, or of course Pink Floyd. Abbey Road is also the first ever purpose-built studio in the world. Now, the artists I've mentioned, they mainly recorded in Studio 2, but Studio 1, where we've recorded our sample library here, is actually the centerpiece of Abbey Road. On the 12th of November 1931, almost 90 years ago, the studio opened its doors with Sir Edward Elgar and the LSO performing and recording his piece Land of Hope and Glory. Originally, it was built for recording classical music. So in the early days, some recordings of really historic works were made. Elgar's Violin Concerto, Beethoven's 32 piano sonatas, Franz Liszt, Piano Sonata and Funeraille, Bach's number 1 and 2 from the cello suites, Stravinsky's Ballet Petrushka or Vaughan Williams' Symphony number 5. Nowadays, pretty much everything recorded at Studio One is film or game music. Let me take you on a journey. Let's make an epic start. I say epic starts, but as we'll move through the scores recorded at Abbey Road Studio One, you'll see there was a lot of epicness in terms of film scores. Anyway, Raiders of the Lost Ark, 1981, 40 years ago. Of course, we all know this one, the score to Steven Spielberg's action-adventure film starring Harrison Ford, composed and conducted by no other than John Williams. It was nominated for an Oscar, but lost to Vangelis' score Chariots of Fire. You will actually know most of the scores I'm playing to you, but it's quite fascinating to realize that Abbey Road is not only famous for the Beatles or Pink Floyd, but for all of those really amazing scores, and now we have the exact same sound right under our fingertips. 2 years later, 1983, I think this needs no words. Let me highlight the first Oscar-winning score, which is The Last Emperor, written by David Byrne, Ryuichi Sakamoto and Kung Su. Of course, in the same year, Robocop was recorded, which was written by Basil Poledouris. Let's jump into the 90s. This one is one of Thomas Newman's lighter works. I'm talking about Little Women. In the same year, he scored Shawshank Redemption and was nominated for the Oscar for both scores, yet lost to Hans Zimmer for Lion King. Newman wasn't only nominated for two Oscars, but he also scored over five films in total in 1994. Now the next one really puts me in a nostalgic place. It also doesn't really need an introduction. It's James Horner's score to Braveheart. In the same year as he scored Apollo 13, he was nominated for an Oscar for both, but lost to Louis Bacalov's The Postman. An interesting fact is that Horner actually didn't use Scottish but Irish bagpipes called Julian pipes. They would blend better with the orchestra due to a smoother tone, and they also have like a wider range. 1999 was a good year for Abbey Road's Studio One. It had a bunch of really incredible scores recorded, kicking it off with two women composers, the first one being Rachel Portman for Chocolat. Thank you. and the second one for Eyes Wide Shut by Jocelyn Pook. Other scores recorded during that year were Notting Hill by Trevor Jones, Sleepy Hollow by Danny Elfman, and The Talented Mr. Ripley by Gabriel Jarret. Moving into our century, now in the year 2000, Harry Gregson-Williams and John Powell created the score for Shrek. Now for the year 2001, I'm not going to say much. I think let's just listen to those wonderful scores. In 2002, Howard Shore scored one of my personal favorite films, Gangs of New York. Another favorite one, purely for the score, is John Bryan's Punch Drunk Love. I actually used that score a lot for inspiration and reference, and apparently him and the director were after this kind of vintagey sound and made use of this famous mic cupboard at Abbey Road. And when you listen to the score, it really reminds you of the silent movies, the Chaplin movies, 40s, 50s in Hollywood. Now there's a series of scores recorded by the fantastic Alexandre Desplat. He's made his Hollywood entrance with the 2003 film Girl with a Pearl Earring and has since then, as we all know, written fantastic movie scores. Let me highlight this one, 2009 Fantastic Mr. Fox. Then in 2010, another really famous one, Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, part 2, and I'm playing you, of course, Lily's theme, which was, by the way, sung by the Japanese singer Mei Chuisawa. Then in part 1 of Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows, we recognize another really famous track, which is called Obliviate. Since I've started playing with our Abbey Road One plugin and preparing this video, I've created a Spotify playlist with all of those tracks that I'm addressing here in my video. And obviously I've been listening to them, see how the sound behaves, see the parallels between the recorded sound and the library, helping me getting my ears used to the mix, etc. I obviously got inspired as well. So having just listened to Oblivion, you can tell that I got inspired by this track in this section here of my track. Just this string movement here. Combined with the high strings, giving a bit of a counter melody there. Adding the woodwinds there, staccatissimo to it. So again, this is an ensemble, so the woodwinds, it's not just flutes, but it's in the kind of like flute, clarinet, high oboe kind of range around there. And the orchestration and the mix are just fantastic. By the way, we'll get to that in the tutorial, but I'm mainly using the mix here. So they're mixes for a reason, but I highly recommend playing with the vintage mics as well, which sounds absolutely fantastic. Just very simple, but it just sits really well because it's all, again, nicely orchestrated for you. This next score is definitely iconic too, recorded in 2012 by another one of my favorite composers, Alan Silvestri. Of course, I'm going to mention it. The biggest franchise, I think, at the moment, Call of Duty. Black Ops 2 was recorded at Abbey Road 2, and the score was written by Jack Wall. In 2013, Stephen Price recorded the Academy Award-winning soundtrack for Gravity, his third job as a feature film composer. Imagine that, what an amazing story. Though he was no unknown to the industry, he's been around for 15 years, doing all sorts of jobs from T-boy to, as said, Academy Award-winning composer. Now I'd like to highlight two more very important and recent scores. The first one being the incredible Academy Award-winning score to the 2018 movie Black Panther by the Swedish composer and producer Ludwig Göransson. The story and production of the soundtrack is incredible, and I recommend you to read it. He spent several weeks in Senegal and South Africa to research and record rare instruments. He accompanied Senegalese musician Baba Mal on one of his tours, who then helped him with his research and also provided his voice for the score. And the sound is phenomenal. The last score I'd like to look at is from the 2019 war film 1917, composed by Thomas Newman. Him and the director Sam Mendes have collaborated frequently, and the first one being American Beauty. Let's have a listen to 1917. What a wonderful and warm sound. So here again, I've tried to be inspired by this kind of arrangement, by this like compact and beautiful movements of the strings and in Newman's arrangement as well. It's unbelievable that we can say this, that we have sounds that are recorded in the same room as all these amazing scores. Just hear a quick section of the strings only. So here, as you can tell, the sound is a little bit muted. So that's because I'm using here consorts sections. So again, it's the whole ensemble of the strings. But as you can see here, I'm dividing them. This is just because it helps me arranging, and I might send different amounts of reverbs to higher strings than to low strings, etc. But essentially, it's all the same ensemble here. Wow, how lovely. So long consorts here I'm using in my first half of the track, and then afterwards I'm opening up and I'm switching my articulations to the longs there. I'm using some high tremolos to build a little bit of tension, and then my low bass again here with very little reverb. In the mic section, sometimes I add, actually I haven't here, but I think I'm going to add a little bit of close. I do that very often, that's on the low strings, that raspiness of the bass. I quite like it, so I give it a little bit more presence. And of course, as always, your modulation and programming of the strings is very important to give, breathe life into these MIDI performances. Here I use my Korg Nano Control 2, and I use here the faders to address expression and dynamics. Before diving into the other sections, I just want to address a little bit the composition. So chord-wise, like in 1917 in that piece, it's a little bit of a repetition of chords, and the intensity changes and the dynamic changes. And I see that quite often also in film music, that it goes through similar progressions, but then the arrangement changes, the chord inversions, the instrumentation, etc. And I quite like that. So you play with the sound and the arrangement rather than theoretical harmonic structure in that sense. And I've also wanted to give a little bit of my touch to it, and I got inspired by maybe Olafur Arnalds, Dustin O'Halloran, neoclassical artists, so to speak. My chords are very simple: F minor, E flat, B flat minor, and D flat. Apart from the end, I'm doing a bit of a variation and just kind of a turnaround to finish the song or the track. And I usually write on the piano, and so I've done this time as well. But then I quite liked keeping it in, and I actually recorded my piano here. So it's a double felted piano for this one, of course, double felted, and I've kept it in. I've also just freshly tuned it, so I was all excited that it sounds nice. And then I've played it without a click. I like doing that. It gives a human feel to it. And then you can kind of create this tempo map. So you would then go here, beat mapping. So you have to make sure that a beat mapping here is ticked. And then you select your track. And then you go here, beat mapping, analyze transients. So now it analyzes my transients. And if we go in here, it creates here, basically, whenever there's an impact, a transient, it creates like a marker, right? And then I can go here again, and then you go beats from region. And then I can go here per note, actually. So that's why it keeps changing here per quarter note. But I want that because I want quite an accurate grid, because it helps me then afterwards orchestrating and arranging the rest of the orchestra and the MIDI information. So then I click OK, and that's how it creates this tempo map. And then you have a grid as if it was just a singular tempo. I find that quite an amazing feature here, because then if we go in here, let's say here the shorts, as you can see, they're all on the grid, even though the tempo is moving more or less wildly. So I kept the piano in. I wanted a little bit of an effect on the piano, so I sent some audio to my chorus echo up there. It's a tape delay, tape echo. It's got a bit of reverb as well. I've printed it out here so you can hear how this sounds. Actually, I'm going to play this, the piano and the chorus echo together, and then you will hear how it sounds separately as well without the chorus echo. So you can see the chorus echo adds a nice depth to it. It's a little bit extreme on its own, but with the orchestra, it just adds this certain, how can I say, 3D-ness to it. Got some other reverbs. I'm talking you through it in a second, how it sounds solo. I've recorded the piano with a pair of coals, as I always do, straight into my UAD interface. No like preamps or any fancy outboard compressors or anything like it. Add a bit of hall, VSS3. When I stop it, you can hear it just very subtly. Number two here was my chorus echo, but I've printed it out, so I don't need that signal. Number three is a UAD EMT140 plugin. It's called Piano Delight. It's a preset I'm using that I quite like. It's plate reverb. And then number four, it's a stereo enhancement, UAD EMT140 as well. And I quite like this combination of those basically four reverbs I have on the piano. All very subtle. I have a compressor on the piano. It's quite heavily compressed because I just like to be it, for it to be there and not really jump out that much. It's not a solo piano track. It's merely to give a bit of an atmosphere and to kind of keep the track afloat with these kind of arpeggiated and gentle pulses I'm giving. This is the EQ I'm using for my piano. I'm adding here a little bit. I quite like adding around 4,500 K. I like to add a little bit more, but again, more in a solo circumstance and not within another track. And here I like the Fab Filter Pro EQ because you can, it's like almost like acts like a multiband compressor as well. So you can here kind of compressed a little bit a certain signal rather than taking it out. So here in the mid, I actually took out fairly little, 2 dB, but then I'm compressing in case there's some notes hitting that range a little bit more. It compresses those frequencies. So that's my piano. Sorry, that was a little bit, there's a lot of stuff going on for the piano, but I think it's quite interesting. There is some fantastic demos that Paul Dunn or Christian and Louis, all the other guys. And I thought I want to explore a little bit the quiet layer, so the dynamically very soft layers. And I just give a little bit of just a brassy color here and there if we have a listen what I'm doing with them. So as you can tell, quite low, quite heavy actually in the arrangements, giving a little bit of breathing points here and there, which adds to your realism. The woods, I like to add the woods like staccatos or runs, and then for certain solo elements here as back here. But here at the low woods are actually creating a little bit of a counter melody. So if we have that together with the brass, I mean the low woods are, let me actually just play this by itself quickly because the low woods sound so lovely. Really cool sound if we have it together with the brass here. Again, there, programming and giving the player time to breathe is quite important to add to your realism. So here basically just mixing brass and woodwinds to create an interesting timbre and texture that is a little bit different than just strings, but everything quite slowly moving. Strings, they're doing a fantastic job. I just absolutely love the sound. And you can see here the programming. It's just kind of, I breathe when I program these strings to get like these waves and coming in and out, and it just makes the track very, very dynamic. And then here, first example of having some woodwinds, staccato. Again, playing with the dynamics. Here you achieve the dynamics by velocity. Together with the low woodwinds, staccato. And again, these are not just single instruments. So the high woods is probably in that range, a bit of a mix between flutes, clarinet, oboe, and the low woods here is probably more bassoon, bass clarinet, etc. Together with the strings. That is quite nice, but then adding the brass, it really gets warm. Again, very, very subtle there, all the elements together. I forgot to mention the percussion. I mean, the percussion section is actually really, really fantastic here. It sounds so cool. Let me just actually get the ensemble up. So I play you a few hits. So we have, like, for example, a full ensemble as well. Again, that's like nicely arranged for you. These low, soft booms, they're really nice. I'm using them actually in my intro. Some metals here only. We have swells and all sorts of cymbal hits, etc. Here you have them separately, if you want to address them separately. I like these Verdi drums here. Put a bit of sample delay on it, so it just makes it, gives you the impression as if it comes from both sides. So it delays one side just a little bit, and then you have like this enhanced stereo image of your percussion. That's quite a nice little trick there. So let's move on to my next section and see what's going on. The cello is taking a bit of a lead line here. So I said everything is on consort, and then the cello here opens up a little bit with a bit more of a lead line. This section, I said before, I've showed you this already, is a little bit taken from Obliviate here. Just the short movement here. Wow, how beautiful is that? So just this daga daga kind of sound here. And then here the high strings, they give like a counter rhythm there to enhance the feel of that kind of slightly busier section there. And then here at the same time, I'm changing into long. So basically the players have no mute on, so the sound is open. I like doing that. Like you go with other libraries as well, you go from flautando to consort to longs, etc. Just in case you have a piece that kind of opens up, and it's without doing much in the arrangement or going to different chords, just sound wise, it gives you a different emotion, a different feel. Solo here, oboe. So, and then there it really opens up and pulls on the heartstrings, etc. So what's exactly happening? So I was saying here, the oboe solo, it's kind of doesn't answer to this melody here. Strings come in. And then here in the brass, I'm using these swells. So these swells are not programmed, they're actually recorded, and the actual recorded stuff, of course, always sounds better than the programmed stuff. Really cool there. So that's the only time when I'm getting into the brassy kind of region of the brass instruments. And all these brass swells together sound like this. Mm-hmm. It's actually a really warm sound when they start right on the bottom there. And then the woodwinds get into runs here. They're just little flavors within the composition. You don't really realize that consciously. It just adds to the busyness and to the urge of that section. Here, I'm just going up and then back down the scale, basically. Soft booms, I quite like. Verdi drums. And then just adding the strings there with the longs. Right in the end, doing a typical thing, which is first and second violin playing in unison, but an octave apart. Again, here I thought I'd just put that on the same track because it will address the right instrument within the programmed ensemble there, if that makes sense. Here, longs, perfect. Actually, I could add a little bit more reverb here, probably to the higher register there. Could do with a little bit more air. So, and then in the end, just a very gentle tremolo there, and the piano, you can hear it quite well. The tape effect there, just to have a little bit of fun right there in the end. So let's have a very quick look at how I'm setting up my session and how I'm mixing this. I always do this. I send all my strings into one bus. You can do an advanced thing where you send the strings shorts, the strings effects, the strings longs, etc. to separate buses, and then you have more control in the overall mix. But I think for the purpose of this piece and this project, I think it's enough to send all the strings to one bus here. And I'm doing that to then also send all the brass into one bus and the woodwind into one bus, and so I can then see the levels of each section. So as I explained in previous tutorials, I first balance my string section, so I go through it, make sure I hear everything really well and balanced. Actually, here maybe we could turn up the bass. I just turn the volume up there a little bit, but I would not just randomly turn it up. Obviously, I would go through the whole piece, many times the loudest section, and I would also change the dynamic or the expression, which is actually the volume, to adjust in certain positions. But then in the mix, I check the overall balance, that I can hear everything. I use my ears and visually hear a little bit. And then I go through the sections, do that for the brass as well, for the woodwinds. And then I said, sending them through the bus, and then I can see all the levels, how they are, whether I need to add a little bit. Obviously, always use your ears, but the visual aspect here helps you sometimes. These are all the plugins I've used for the piano. I've explained you already. For the strings on the string bus, I'm using this. Helps to make the sound a little bit silkier. I'm taking out a tiny bit of the 2K. This is just a creative choice. By all means, it's not that the Abbey Road sounds come with an annoying frequency there. This is literally just a preferred sound and adding a little bit of air right there. But as you can see, this is very, very little I'm doing there. Nothing more than 2 dB. I don't need to correct anything. Or people sometimes ask me what EQ and compressor I use on our sample libraries, but actually rarely that much, unless it's a creative choice. Because you have to imagine, these things are recorded with the best engineers, best gear, best desks, best players. So it would have to be perfect, as you imagine, or definitely really good, you know. For the percussion here, I'm adding, talking about compressor here, this dresser here, UAD, just to unify a little bit the percussion, just sending it all through there in case I have some hits or some certain small percussion jumping out a little bit too much. It's actually quite high. I usually don't have it that high, but I have this kind of like low thumb in there. That's kind of just want to smoothen out a little bit. And then I'm sending bus number 5. I'm sending a little bit of reverb to percussion kind of plate here. But again, very little because I mainly have low stuff. So I don't want to muddy it up. And then I think that's pretty much it. Here, brass. I usually like to send individual reverbs of the instruments. Brass, I thought they could do with a little bit more. So I added an extra bit of reverb there to my brass section. Again, this was my RE501. Just send it out of the system to the machine, and then it comes back and I've printed it. I also printed it with a little bit of reverb. So I put reverb on the reverb and the delay just to unify the whole track. Then for a master, this is usually where I go from. So I go, have a bit of compression. I've changed it because I had several discussions whether it's compression or EQ first. And someone said if you do the EQ first and then compress it, you affect how much the EQ will affect your sound because you compress the frequencies, so the EQ will be less effective. So if you want the EQ to carry all its power, put it after the compressor. And so I definitely want that. So I compress a little bit with this SSL plugin here by UAD. Very fantastic plugin, highly recommended. Very slow attack, fairly fast release, and the needle does barely move, to be honest. See, only in the very peaks, it just kind of moves a little bit. So I would never compress on the master bus more than 2 or 3 dBs, really. But it allows me to, again, unify the track a little bit, bring it to kind of a level that I can then raise with the limiter. A little bit of makeup gain if the track is quiet. Then I'm using this Oxford EQ, take out the low bits there. Sometimes I take out a little bit around 3K. That sometimes can be a little bit harsh there, but just use your ears and raise it all the way up and see whether there's something there that bothers you. Then I'm using UAD plugin as an EQ just to raise a little bit the high frequencies. As you can see here, very little, 1 dB from around 4-5K, and then 1 dB and 1.5 dB like up in the upper ranges, just to add a little bit of air. Sometimes I use a tape. Again, use your ears, turn it off, turn it on, see whether you like the sounds or not. That's just my only recommendation. That's just a bit of a, you know, fun thing to play with, this tape emulator there. I use an imager. Again, use your ears. I like it in ambient tracks and slow tracks, not when there is vocals, for example, or action EQs, etc. Ozone 5, widespread preset there. Just opens up the track a little bit. And then L3 Ultra Maximizer, just a normal setting, high-res CD master. And if I need to raise a little bit the volume, then I kind of just wiggle here this fader, ceiling usually at minus 0.1. And then I try to, in my, you know, highest peaks, not to compress more than 2 dB. Otherwise, it just sounds distorted and I think it loses in dynamic. Always favor dynamic before loudness, I feel. Sometimes I don't understand the loudness war that well if the dynamic has to suffer. So I hope you've enjoyed our journey through nostalgia land. And yeah, please share your thoughts on the library, on Abbey Road. Share some scores that I forgot to mention and let us know why you love them, what you love about Abbey Road, what you love about these scores. And I hope the tutorial was insightful. I see you on the next one. Thank you very much for your time. Take care. Bye-bye.